Hello and welcome to the Indian Writers Forum. Today we have with us three very young students, some of them also teachers and students, who will be will be discussing the triple talaq judgment that came out. So let me first introduce some of our panelists. First we have Zainab. Zainab is a student at LSR. She's an undergraduate student doing her BA. Heba is a PhD scholar at Jawaharlal Nehru University. And Feba Rashid is from Delhi University. She just completed her MPhil and she also teaches in a Delhi University college. The judgment came out last week, so can I first begin with your initial reactions? So Feba, would you like to begin?
Yes, actually, when the judgment came out, basically the press had very elaborate captions which said that the court has declared it unconstitutional, and now this is a historic judgment for, especially for Muslim women. You know, basically it was like everybody has saved Muslim women. But then, of course, gradually when we read into the articles, we realized that there is nothing like unconstitutional. Basically, what I understood is that the judgment basically set aside the case for the legislature to decide. And this is a, I felt it was very ambiguous that way. I mean, it did not actually talk about what about those women who actually filed these petitions, what about their maintenance, all such things were not even discussed. Which was really interesting was the right-wing rhetoric along with that of the liberals were pretty much similar. And the entire rhetoric that way seemed really interesting in the sense how as a community or maybe as different people who have come together, how certain opinions and things have merged together. And that was something really interesting. And of course, as Muslim women, as a Muslim woman myself, I feel that of course, the initial reaction being that first thing, personal law is something which is held really close by Muslims because of the very logic that it does not actually share a lot of grounds with that of the secular law. So, which is why we really had this kind of uncertainty and disturbance with regard to such judgments, which basically do not give you a lot of insight, but are taken for granted by the public conscience, especially in a country where to satisfy the public conscience has even led to death penalties. So, I think that is something we discuss now. Maybe I'll...
Heba?
In a perfect world, legal reform would be appreciated as actually happening for reasons of gender justice. It would be said that legal reform has happened because the state is interested in ensuring that Muslim women, that women from marginalized communities do not suffer discrimination within their communities. But the Indian state is far from that state of perfection. So there is obviously legitimate ground for Muslim women to be suspicious of this judgment. But I will not begin my analysis of this judgment from a point of suspicion. I would say that there are several Muslim women activists who are celebrating this judgment. And the reason why they are doing this is because the five Muslim women petitioners, Shaira Bano, Gulshan Parveen, etc., they did suffer a lot of indignity in their marital life. So the judgment tries to alleviate their position in their marital life. But what were the reasons? What were the reasons given by the court to invalidate instant triple talaq? Now, let me just make a quick point about what has been declared, what has been abolished. Instant triple talaq or triple talaq? Now the media says it's triple talaq. Actually, it's instant triple talaq because in the Quran, there is a very elaborate and gender just procedure for divorce, which is triple talaq and which says that when a man and has to divorce his wife, he should go through the process of triple talaq, which says that both parties, that is the man and the woman, both parties will employ their arbitrators, and there will be a period of 3 months during which both the husband and the wife have to live together as a married couple, and during which the wife will get full rights as her status as a wife, her dignity as a wife will be respected during that three-month period. It's called the period of iddat. And only after that, if the situation between the husband and the wife seems insoluble, only then the process of divorce will be finalized. Now, that is a procedure which is already established in the Quran. And all the four schools of Islamic jurisprudence, there is no concurrence, because what is there in the Quran has, of course, been debated by the Hanbali school, by the Shafi school. So because of those disagreements, Islamic jurisprudence has a bit of confusion about whether instant triple talaq can be legally validated. Now, one fact has been maintained that instant triple talaq is actually an innovation. It's called talaq-e-bidda. So it's an innovation. So it is not Islamic. In the Islamic perspective, it is not valid. But let's see. Let's come back to the judgment. And the judgment, like I mentioned before, the judgment could not express a valid reasoning to declare triple talaq, instant triple talaq, invalid or illegal, because the judgment has tried to say that triple talaq is un-Islamic or unconstitutional, but it has not expressly mentioned that it is discriminatory for Muslim women. So it was unable to allow a gendered reading of the constitution. It was unable to reconcile the constitutional validity the constitutional invalidity of instant triple talaq and the Islamic invalidity of instant triple talaq. This is actually very ironical. What the court was unable to do, actually Muslim women's groups has been able to do very well. So if you look at organizations like Beba Collective or Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan or Awaz-e-Niswa, or in Bengal you have the, I'm forgetting that name. Yeah, but what these Muslim women's groups have been able to do is to say that instant triple talaq contravenes the rights of Muslim women as per Islamic tenets and as per constitutional provisions, as given in part 3 of the constitution, which establishes right to equality as also a fundamental right of Muslim women. But if you look at the judgment has not been able to, as I said, to give a reconciled position of the invalidity of triple talaq vis-a-vis Islamic perspectives and vis-a-vis constitutional provisions. What it said was that it's un-Islamic. But then that opens up another vast debate about personal laws. And it's another unclear and ambiguous position within Indian law if personal laws of religions are a fundamental right. Article 25 gives every individual the freedom of conscience, but does it also give them the freedom to follow personal laws? There is no clear standing on this. So if you leave the arena of Muslim women's rights linked to personal laws, then you are allowing that ambiguity to remain. So if this Indian state advocates for an imposition of uniform civil code, what happens to the rights of Muslim women? So that ambiguity has been totally left unaddressed by the court, which is why I think this judgment has, that is the left certain gaps of the judgment. And as regards the media generated hype about this judgment is that it is the state, it is the Modi-led government which has actually engineered this legal reform, which is actually totally false, because this hype invisibilizes the struggles of Muslim women. It invisibilizes the struggle of Muslim women's activist groups which have been working for Muslim women, not just on the issue of abolition of instant triple talaq, but also for many other issues which are not highlighted by the media at all. And the reason why this invisibilization needs to be challenged is because Muslim women face two levels of marginalization on account of being Muslims and on account of being women. And their activism regarding the abolition of instant triple talaq has actually challenges their marginalization. But the media has ignored that. So, of course, there is reason for me to be suspicious of why we are celebrating the judgment. Let's celebrate it for the right reasons, not for the wrong reasons piped up by a hyper-nationalist media.
Mm. Maybe for a media that doesn't even care to understand some of the various nooks and corners of the judgment, yeah. Or maybe hasn't even read it.
Yeah.
Who knows?
So very much similar to what these people said. This whole judgment is ambiguous by itself. Very ambiguous in the sense that it Heba pointed it rightly that there are a lot of gaps in the judgment. You won't understand what actually those people meant by the five judges meant by the judgment. Now, if we actually go into the judgment, we'll understand that it is actually nothing new. Nothing new in the sense triple talaq has already been invalidated in 2002, and this particular judgment that recently happened adds nothing to it. And what we see here is there's a certain politics to it. That's something totally like we have got to discuss about it. But then what I don't understand about this judgment is that these five judges have given enormous time and energy to the case. Mm-hmm. So a case or an issue that has already been invalidated by 2002, why was it that it was again taken right now? Okay, so that if it was again taken, then there should be a certain addition to what they actually have to say. Mm-hmm. Right now, we what we understand is that the case has been set aside, mm-hmm. and nothing more to it. So, and as Heba said, the talaq in Islam or the divorce in Islam is actually a very long procedure. It takes actually minimum of 3 months, which is actually like, yeah, she said the technical aspects of it. Mm-hmm. But what the public actually says, and me being from LSR, which actually calls itself a feminist space, which is obviously a liberal feminist space, what I feel very disturbing when I study there or when I am in the classrooms and everything, the day after the judgment, the day after the judgment came out, the day was fully hyped up with discussions on how Muslim women are actually liberated and how these judges actually saved and stuff. Mm. So Muslim women are liberated, and that's how the discussion went on. And it was like, you have to necessarily celebrate what actually the judgment was, otherwise you are not necessarily feminist. So, mm-hmm. so when this is a problem I have with the whole liberal feminist theory. So the thing is, I don't myself associate to any of those because I cannot identify with any of those. Mm-hmm. I don't find myself, saved because of this judgment, but I don't feel I'm trapped. We like when they say Muslim women are liberated, we are already liberated by what is like what we have in our Islamic what we have in Islamic jurisprudence. Mm-hmm. But what is happening right now, and when you take the statistics of triple talaq, it's very less, it's very marginal. So the thing is, even if there's one person at the receiving end of the instant triple talaq, then you have to take it into action, like you have to take it into discussion and stuff, then you have to discuss it out. But in this judgment, what you see is there is nothing, there's literally nothing. And the judgment is really, really unclear, and we can't really understand what the judges actually meant. They did not even say anything about the maintenance of the five women who actually petitioned. So I think that the kind of politics that is played around it, that is more than any of it.
Hmm. I'm sorry, Zainab, I'm actually a little unaware of the 2002 case that you've been referring to. Can you first?
The Shamima case basically brought out this judgment, actually. Mm-hmm. And it said that...
Yeah, you have to begin from the beginning.
With regard to the Shamimara case, this was the judgment. Basically, they've held on to whatever was conveyed then. I want to start somewhere else. Let's begin here, where we have the Shah Banno case, the very much celebrated and uncelebrated as well, as because it has two sides to the coin. Some of them say that the Congress government was very influential and they wanted to appease the minorities. Therefore, there was a lot of complexities with regard to this case. But we do not take into consideration that this case actually paved way for this law of which came into force, which was the Muslim Women's Act of 1986, which actually gives a long, an elaborate idea about the provisions, and which is very much liberating to the Muslim women themselves, if you are to take a feminist point of view. But the point is this, that when we look at these cases, like Zainab said, which does not even amount to 1% of the entire divorce cases, it is in one of the articles which came in News Laundry, which Fasila writes, she actually says that how none of the students, even of undertake legal studies, are not interested in what these petitions say. They are not even ready to actually look into the petitions. What are the petitions? Why are they filed for? Now, even with regard to the period of Iddah, I would like to disagree a little here, because the period of Iddah, you basically stay away, and it is also to know that, you are not pregnant, or, so that there is no child, and it is closely related to the provisions of maintenance. Now, that is why I want to stress that the idea of maintenance is really important here, because even during the period of Iddah, even I've seen in Kerala, sometimes women have
In the period of Iddah, you have to actually stay in the same house, like stay in the husband's house. But no,
you
marital
have a provision.
Yeah.
You can stay away from
the house. But you cannot actually have marital relations between you.
Which means the ideal thing is to stay away. But it is a provision. You can stay away in your parents' house. But there are cases where people actually stay in their parents' house and go through a lot of torture because of the social stigma attached to it. But if you look at the Islamic communities, of course, we live in a mixed society. It's a liberal society. So, and we do have a lot of different perspectives which we develop when we live in a society which is a democracy like India. But if you live in a major Muslim country, this might not be the situation. I'm talking specifically to India. So the issue is that we have a lot of other social stigmas and ideas of honor and purity. That is the issue we need to also probe into. We can't say that this is something related to the Islamic laws. And the idea in Islam is that marriage is a contract. It's not something like a sacramental thing in Christianity where, the body becomes one. Or, for example, like in Hinduism where you have, saat janmo ka saat hota. It's nothing like that. Something interesting you can refer to is that Muslim women are, encouraged to change their father's names, which they attach to their own names, because, you have the...
Yes. The point about being a contract is that if a contract is made, it can also be broken.
Yes, exactly.
So marriage is not held to be an essentially indissoluble
or kind of transcendental, but
yes,
more of a pragmatic.
So that is actually a feminist perspective, that if you are having problems in your marriage, you can, of course, opt out of it. Unlike other religions where the provisions of divorce are actually stigmatized. You can't. A divorced woman has a stigma, but Islam does not permit that.
Perspective, I don't exactly know, but then in Islam it is like that. If you look at it, because we do, there are encouragements with regard to second marriages as well as polygamy. So it is a system which is totally different to the understanding of be it a Christian society or a Hindu society. So the idea is this. So I've seen a lot of cases in my own life where, second marriages take place very easily, and you don't have any social stigma attached to it. You have this famous work by Leila Abu Leila, who actually writes a novel, and you have her saying that, you know, Allah's laws are better than that of the people, where she says that, you know, the with the period of 3 months, 4 months, where, yeah, the widow has to also follow this. She's like, after that, she is free to get married. The woman is actually asking for a marriage. Mm-hmm. So we don't have these kinds of stigma that, you know, okay, I will stay a pativrata and, you know, worship the dead husband, or I am an outcast from the society. No, even if you go for weddings, you go for any functions, people who do not have a husband for any reason, they are not like, you know, yes, you do have social issues, you have stigmas attached to it, but then they are promoted to get married. So, like, you know, people are like, take care of yourselves, so you can have a future. So that option is always there. But, like, even when you look at the same article, some of the cases, you find that actually the idea that the honor of the family should be taken up, which is very much central to Hindu society, is again forwarded in several cases here, even when it comes to courts. So we can't say that, you know, it is an elaborate system where they are taking into consideration the nuances of an Islamic living or Islamic livelihood. And one more thing is that in the same article, Fasila is actually talking about a case where this triple talaq issue is actually boosted, where you have the case of a Hindu woman who's actually fighting for her property rights, her ancestral rights, and when she is getting divorced. Case, I'm not very sure of it, but that is the case where she says that in the entire judgment, out of the blue, the court actually takes up a stand that, you know, you have to also look into issues of triple talaq, which are oppressive to Muslim women. Why? You are doing an injustice where she is not given the property to the Hindu woman, and then you are bringing in the oppressed state of Muslim women, where you are only looking at a specific case which is already dealt with. Because if you look at the 39-page document which the Muslim Personal Law Board came with, they are clearly stating that instantaneous triple talaq is not something they find to be valid. So you have a clear statement there. You have cases which have very similar judgments, but that is why such a public celebration of this is meaningless, and it is actually kind of unsettling, because at this point of time, especially when we know that persecutions of the Muslim community, especially the Muslim male figure, who's again being demonized here as the... Because there are also cases where, you know, men are to pay a huge amount in maintenance, where such cases are not even spoken about. So this is like you are reducing the men's rights as in terms of divorce. Sometimes even women rely on these rights. This is not even discussed. There have been studies which have said that they can't go through these tense procedures in the court, where, you know, in especially in Special Marriage Act or Hindu, in case of Hindu Marriage Act, you have a period of 6 months to 1 year where you have to stay away and, you know, you have to stay together. There are lots of provisions like that. I'm not very sure of it. But here you have a system where you can get out of it in a very minimal amount of time, and maybe go into another marriage or live separately. And you also have forms of, you know, demanding divorce in case of women. That's not even discussed, which is khula, where you can approach Islamic body, and you also have fusk, where you don't even have to do that.
Okay.
That's basically it.
Before I get comments, I just wanted I would like to bring up one point that Zainab had made, but we'll take it up in the second half. Thank you for watching. Please stay tuned. We'll soon come back with the second half.